the capacity for evolution is in fact built into the planet and the natural world in which we live. Now, one often hears this word about chance or random evolution. And the notion that evolution is random is not at all the same as the scientific observation that evolution is in fact undirected. We cannot detect a direction or an order in which mutations appear or change occurs. But natural selection, which is really the key part of evolution, isn't random at all. And natural selection is driven by natural law. And it is natural selection in different regions of adaptive space that drives the evolutionary convergence that we see across all aspects of paleontology and natural history.
And what I mean by chance is a very, very simple, because I can't handle any more complicated idea, is that two atoms of hydrogen meet in the early universe. They have to make hydrogen molecule. They have no choice. That's what chemistry is all about. So it's destined, it's necessitated. But they don't at this time and place in the universe because the pressure and temperature conditions are not correct. So they don't combine. So they wander throughout the universe. They meet trillions of times. There are trillions of hydrogen atoms from all of these stars pouring out chemistry. What is to surprise us if a few million, a few billion times, we get a hydrogen molecule? So we get two hydrogen molecules. They meet in oxygen. They have to make water. So you go on for 14 billion years, all building up this more complex chemistry, some of it decomposing, but going forward to more complex chemistry until you get the human brain. So you go on for 14 billion years, all building up this more complex chemistry, some of it decomposing, but going forward to more complex chemistry until you get the human brain.
The emergence of sentient, self-aware organisms, that's what we are, is directly driven by the physical constants of our universe. In other words, the capacity to evolve something like human beings. It doesn't have to be hairless bipedal primates, but the capacity to evolve sentient, self-aware beings is built into the fabric, the physical constants of the universe. Now, I actually talked about this issue with Steve Gould, who was a friend of mine before he passed away. And Steve would say you could never use evolution as the tool to fulfill the intent of a creator. Because if you wound the tape back, that comet that destroyed the dinosaurs might not hit. And instead of hairless bipedal primates, that would be us, occupying this dish, you might get big brain dinosaurs. Or you might get large brain birds. And my answer to Steve was, how do we know that the designer or the creator wanted primates? He might have been very happy with bipedal big brain dinosaurs, because the issue of us is not, when scripture says that we are made in the image and likeness of God, that does not mean that God is a primate. The image and likeness is a spiritual one, and that spiritual one would apply as well to the kind of organism that today we call a bird, or the kind of organism that today we call a reptile. It's not our mammalness that makes us special. It is our self-awareness, our ability to reason, and our sentient powers that make us special.
Did this happen by chance or necessity? By both. if the conditions were correct, and they're not always correct, so there's a probability, a chance that they will be correct, then this will necessarily happen. So you have both chance and necessity, but in a fertile universe. And that's a very important ingredient. If you have enough chemistry, okay, this is going to go forward inevitably to more complex organisms.
In short, in a sense, one might say, the universe is such that we were meant to be here.
Because chemistry is what it is, and the universe is what it is with chemistry, physics, etc., you will inevitably see something like this. And I said something like, because the chance processes or chemical decomposition could have been dominant at a certain phase, so that we would have arms that come off our belly buttons and our backs, and it would look funny, except we'd all be that way, so it wouldn't look funny. So I say inevitably and something like. I say something like because that's the nature of the universe.
The capacity to evolve something like human beings, it doesn't have to be hairless bipedal primates, but the capacity to evolve sentient self-aware beings is built into the fabric, the physical constants of the universe.
It doesn't allow anything to happen. The nature of the universe drives this process to the human being.
We are beings who tell ourselves about ourselves, ask questions about ourselves. St. Augustine saying, I have become a question to myself, as a definition of the life of human spirit. We tell jokes, we fantasize, we empathize, we even pray. All of that is an activity of self-reflexive consciousness in a way which doesn't seem to fit at the animal level. And that seems to me to have something to do with the fact that some of us believe we are capable of a relationship with that unconditional creative energy that we call God. And all of those things about our self-awareness, about our self-questioning, have their home in the context of material beings who are nonetheless capable of that sort of relation. It's something which, as several of the early Christian theologians say, emerges in the material life of people subject by subject. It's, to me, very interesting that in the 4th century you have a theologian like Gregory of Nyssa saying some quite evolutionary-sounding things and saying, well, the soul doesn't come in separate. The soul is what gathers all this together when the material processes of development are complete. It's not that extra thing which has to be injected. There has to be a point in the story at which the proto-human becomes conscious of what I'll call in shorthand a call from God or an address from God. That there is a point, if you like, implicit in the whole process from the beginning, a point at which it will be possible for that proto-human to be conscious in another way, including the consciousness of the divine.
Now it is Jesus who is the true glory bearer, the true image bearer, the truly human one. Somebody asked me in a Q&A this afternoon about how we can talk about Jesus being fully divine and fully human. And the answer is, if you understand the doctrine of the image, there is nothing more obvious than if God was going to come into the world, he would come not as a dinosaur or a bush or a this or a that, but precisely as a human being.